for his reaction to these latest health developments. We are joined by Dr. Jean Misperos, a professor at the UP College of Medicine. Good morning, Dr. Jean. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Nikki, and good morning, everyone. Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Lots to digest, but first off, what do you think about President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. issuing an executive order making the wearing of face masks indoors a voluntary? What metrics should government be looking at before lifting the mask mandate? And is this something that the medical community would welcome, if ever?
I think the medical community is a bit more prudent than what the national government wants to do. Right. Mm-hmm. As far as the DOH is concerned, they're saying that despite this order, it's still necessary for us. While it is voluntary to have masks, well, the order is to be voluntary masking indoors, the DOH is still saying that it's important to have layers of protection, including vaccination, masking, distancing, etc. So those things, especially masking, for me, it's the last line of defense we have against the pandemic, which is still around, very much around. It is not, well, people may look at it as non-threatening already because unlike during the beginning of the pandemic when mortalities were very high, the protection that we've had and the adjustments that we've made have made hospitalization and deaths much less. But it doesn't mean that the disease is less vicious. We have to look at the other metrics like long COVID. What are the long-term effects of exposure to COVID, right? Those things have to be taken into consideration. The other is how well our healthcare system is at this point. We've already seen that during the pandemic that our healthcare system, already at the brink of collapse before even the pandemic, was pushed to its limit. And people, even the helpers, especially health personnel, were frustrated, tired, because they were pushed to the limits of what they can do. Now, looking back at that, can we honestly say that we're prepared for the worst case scenario in case the pandemic makes a turn for the worse? So those things we need to put into consideration. Right now, I'm hearing that we want to open up the country to foreigners, even those who are unvaccinated. The restrictions are becoming much less than what they should be. The problem is they keep comparing the Philippines to other countries where the restrictions have become less. That's true, but in those countries, the healthcare system is very good. People's access to health services are much easier compared to ours. So those things have to be taken into consideration. Have we made the necessary adjustments? Those things I haven't seen yet. So it's I think the medical sector, the health sector, is not with government on this one, and we would rather take a more prudent position on masking.
Agreed, Dr. Jean. And what of schools then? We're also seeing an uptick in cases there. Who will decide and monitor for the students? Your thoughts on this?
Yes, definitely. In fact, I want to see what our data is since we've opened up much of our society. We opened up the schools, people are going back to work. Have we been monitoring this? How much of the infection has gone around? Is it easier to get tested now? Is testing, let's say RT-PCR, cheaper, more available? I mean, those things have to be taken into consideration. The public needs to know. Two, how much of our for population have received not just the basic vaccines, but the booster shots? You know, even if you're vaccinated, over time, the protection it confers to an individual may wane. And that's why we need to have booster shots. And those things, wala pa rin tayo, we know for a fact that hindi pa malaking bahagi, not a big population, at least not the targeted population, have been covered by vaccination. So those things have to be taken into consideration also at this juncture.
And especially now, you know, with the last break and the Christmas season, we're approaching.
Yeah, right.
So we expect increased COVID-19 transmission through mobility.
That's right. Magkakaroon ng undas this And then you have Christmas coming up. So in between, you know, there's going to be a lot of shopping and everything. And while we want the economy to really go back, you know, and people going out and engaging with each other, we still have to manage that with some degree of protection. And again, masking is the minimum that we can do, given the fact that, you know, government really has not made the environment around us more a bit safer. No, wala namang masyadong nilabas na regulation, making sure that,
Jean, that
indoor places.
This on top of the highly immune invasive XBB Omicron sub-variant, and then we have the XBC variant of.
Yeah, but some doctors or some experts would say that these are, you know, the new variants are still under study, and even with the development of the new variants, indeed, the mortalities, the hospitalization rates are not that high compared to when it started with the pandemic. So yun yung sinasabi naman nila, no? So pero ang point naman natin diyan, bakit pa natin hihintay magkaroon ng malalang variant? the important thing is to be protected even before that happens, and we cannot just be reactive the way we did during the height of the pandemic. Naalala mo yung the hospitals were overwhelmed. People were not well informed where to go, what to do, how to vet patients. Yung mga kailangan dalhin sa ospital, yun lang sana pupunta sa ospital. Hindi lahat ng mga may symptoms kailangan ng hospitalization. Those things. Now, when we look back at that and we look at our situation now, have those things been addressed? Yun yung gusto lang tanungin, no? Are people more aware of what we to do now? In fact, when the announcement about the voluntary masking indoors came out, a lot of citizens pa nagsabing, no, I'm still going to mask. Kasi nakikita nila yun na lang ang protection, eh. In a situation where health services is so expensive, right? Tapos yung access mo sa health services ay napaka-limited, lalo kung wala kang pera, the only protection you have really is masking. And hopefully...
It's the last line of defense.
Yeah, it's the last line of defense. And it's the least that we can do, you know, given the fact na institutions have not made it really safe. You know, wala namang kasing lumabas na mandate na order ang gobyerno, ordering all these institutions where people converge to make sure that the environment is safe. You know, may mga filters, magandang airflow. Hindi ganun ka-stringent. No? So, dapat tinitimbang yun. Unfortunately, we're in a situation where the government saying, oh, kailangan pumasok ang mga turista, kami kailangan nandito.
Right. Yung I was going to ask that nga po, Dr. Jean. So how significant is it po ba na it was the tourism secretary who announced the policy?
we know that health is not their priority, right? And it doesn't help that we don't have a secretary of health. And despite the commendable effort of the DOH to address all the current issues that we have, a secretary of health would still be an important person who we hope would fight for what we believe in, you know, in terms of protecting our citizens. Isa yun, no? Pangalawa, nandun tayo sa sitwasyon that we have to choose either or, you know, economy, money, and safety. Hindi tastahan na tayo umabot sa ganitong sitwasyon if we made all the fundamental changes and addressed the problems early on, right? If testing and contact tracing was effective, then we wouldn't have these problems because people would know where to go. Kung symptomatic sila, madali silang makakapagpa-test, malalaman nila kung meron sila. You know, things would have been much easier if most of the fundamentals were there, and we wouldn't have to be in this spot right now.
Dr. Jean, wondering, how much of our economy and the way we live our lives are that much adversely affected by the simple wearing of masks? Why is everyone trying to get rid of masks as soon as possible?
Well, I don't know if everyone's trying to get rid of masks as soon as possible. There's certainly a certain section of the population who, I don't know, maybe they're looking at the United States where, you know, it's a struggle that they put it in the frame of a personal individual right. But then we're looking at masking in the context of a public health situation, a public health crisis. So that means masking isn't just for personal interest. it's also protecting our fellow citizens. Sana mm-hmm. ganun natin fine-frame yun. Mm-hmm. Hindi siya usapin lang ng personal accountability and personal responsibility, which right. is how the government has framed COVID-19 mm-hmm. from the onset. It's not. It's about social solidarity. It's about being responsible for the person next to
There's
you. There's
a community
around
you have to think of.
Yeah, right. And mm-hmm. and that is something that has not been fully ingrained in most of the, mm-hmm. the people in, because it's not part of the discussion. Sana yun yung discussion natin na ang pagharap sa COVID ay isang collective effort. It's a community effort. Hindi lang siya, may papel ang bawat individual. Individuals have a role to play. But generally, it's how we face it as a nation. And right now, we're I just want to put it in that kulang tayo ng inspirational leadership as far as that discussion is concerned, as far as that direction is concerned. That is something that needs to be put on the table, and that should still be a substantive part of the discussion, whether it's economy or health, that COVID-19 should be addressed in a collective manner.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Jean, looking at our COVID situation now, mm-hmm. how does it actually compare with other countries who have decided to go maskless? And what are the dangers of self-risk assessment when it comes to wearing masks and the like?
Kasi when we ease restrictions, tapos hindi naman natin na-monitor how those restrictions are actually being implemented, right? How those protocols mm-hmm. are being implemented. The tendency would be to be really lax about it. No, when they made masking outdoors voluntary, even indoors and even the exceptions in places like public transport, marami na hindi nagmamask. Hindi naman yun na mamonitor. No? So how are we going to say that the current safety protocols are effective if we are not monitoring it properly? And plus, the conversation is not there. The public is still not very much in a part mm-hmm. of that conversation. Naririnig ba natin yung sinasabi ng publiko? Nakikita ba natin yung nangyayari on ground? And that's something that we really need to address.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of leadership, no, Dr. Esperos, what's your reaction to the appointment as DOH USEC, a former PNP chief, Kaskolan? Do you agree that this is a, quote, an insult to health experts who are more qualified for the position?
Well, it's an insult to everyone. All Filipino citizens, not just health experts. For one, it's a very brazen and blatant display of patronage politics. They're holding on to the bare minimum of his qualification. Kesyo nakapag-aaral daw siya ng public administration, kesyo the position does not require a health background. That's mm-hmm. not it. The point is, why get someone when you can get that is barely qualified and then work hard to make him mm-hmm. manage to do the job, when in the first place you can hire somebody who is more qualified.
And you have a lot of health experts.
Kasi nga, yun kasi yung problema eh. His apologists are framing it na hindi naman kailangan doktor, hindi naman kailangan experts. That's true. I myself will not say that the DOH should have a slew of doctors leading it. Kasi mm-hmm. hindi naman sana ganon. It should be multidisciplinary. But the point is, it's not just the bare minimum of having the capacity to manage or nakapag-aral ka in some public administration course. The important thing is also is to have that skill set and those knowledge within the context of appreciating the healthcare system. The Philippine healthcare mm-hmm. system is complex. It has a lot of chronic problems that need to be addressed. Now, there are new laws like the universal healthcare law that needs to be implemented by government. Eh, ang salimuot nun, that's very complex. Now, you have to have a full appreciation of the landscape, of the whole health landscape and the social landscape in the Philippines to be able to fully appreciate how you're going to address that, how you're going to do your job. Now, mm-hmm. bakit sa dami ng Pilipino, ba't kukuha ka ng retired general? No, isa yon. The second part is, hindi lang siya police. He's not just a simple police officer. The man has a history with the very bloody anti-drug war. Yes, mm-hmm. right? So just looking at that, he reflects a value system that is anathema to what health represents. Health is a right. We talk about promoting life, protecting life. And here you are putting someone who is supposed to run that agency, who has shown that they have very little regard for human rights, mm-hmm. And human life. So, salungat na salungat. So why, mm-hmm. why that? Para bang wala na ba tayo makitang ibang taong fit for the job? No.
Pero Dr. Jean, what exactly are the problems, Cuba, that could arise should the DOH be headed by soldiers instead of, health professionals?
Well, for one, they're so used to blind loyalty, blind discipline, blind obedience, right? And the very reductionist. They put everything as a matter of peace and order lang yan, usapin lang yan ng supplies, mm-hmm. usapin lang yan. Hindi ganun tinitignan ng kalusugan eh. You have a lot of things to consider when you're talking about the well-being of a person. Numbers are not just numbers when you talk about the health sector. Those numbers reflect human lives, the future of an individual. Those things have to be taken into consideration. For instance, simple management, halimbawa, kung hindi mo napadala yung supplies mo or equipment mo sa isang malayong lugar, you can look at it as, na-delay lang. But it could mean mm-hmm. life and death of somebody, a patient who's waiting
when
for those medication.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to health. So, may appreciation ng ganon na hindi, kailangan may sense of urgency ka, meron kang appreciation na pag hindi mo nagawa yan, it really matters to people. Hindi ito negosyo, hindi ito simpleng paradigm lang na pwedeng gawin ng kahit sino. Kaya nga sinasabi ng mga apologists, pwede naman siyang kumonsulta, pwede naman siyang paligiran ng mga experts or mga doktor dyan sa Department of Health. That's not the point. Mm-hmm. Why do you need to do that if you can actually hire someone who already knows the job, who can already do the job, who has more qualifications than this man? So I think that the conversation that his apologists are trying to push on us is really wrong. And at the end of the day, what does that appointment really reflect? It's just that's it, patronage politics. Nilagay siya dyan kasi gusto lang ng appointing authority ng presidente. I mean, we should stop that practice. We should really stand up and say, hey, teka muna, hindi pwedeng ganyan-ganyan na. The Department of Health is tasked to take care of life and you're just gonna, treat it like this? Mm-hmm. It's insulting to everyone because it shows that this government does not regard health, the health of Filipinos, as something important, as something crucial.
But alas, we are here, no? Lastly, mm-hmm. before we let you go, Dr. G, what are your hopes then for a health secretary since the president has yet to name one?
Well, one, I hope that a health secretary has a perspective of public health and would welcome all voices. So competence and experience are important. But at the same time, I'm hoping that we would have finally a health secretary who is inspiring, not just because they can talk to us, they can talk to us in terms that we want, but a health secretary can stand up to all the other secretaries and mm-hmm. put and say, look, the pandemic is still here, right? Mm-hmm. And we have to do this and that. We don't want a health secretary who would just kowtow to whatever the president says mm-hmm. or what the other members of the cabinet would
want. So it could spell a world of difference.
Yes, it would. And that kind of leadership would be inspiring, mm-hmm. would be something that, hey, okay, I see someone who's standing up for us, and therefore that person may be worth following and supporting.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Dr. Jean Esperos. Thank you for your knowledge and your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Nikki, and thank you very much, everyone. Magandang umaga.